Good morning, everyone. What we are going to do today is have this administrator meeting. We have been collecting questions from people through email, and so we are going to answer those questions first. But please, if you have questions, feel free to write them in the chat at any time, and we will ask those questions once we are through the ones that we have already received. What we are planning to do, as you heard, we are now recording the meeting, and we are going to have a website up in the next week or so, where we are going to have this video available, as well as the questions not only asked today in the presentation, but also the questions in the chat room that we did not get an opportunity to answer, as a list of frequently asked questions on that website also. So again, if your question does not get answered today, please don't worry, we will get to it. And hopefully that will be a great resource for you. We will email you the information about that website as soon as it is available. Right now, I'm gonna introduce Dilo Blau, who is the director of the Office of International Services. And she's going to make a statement and then we will get to the questions. Thank you.
Thanks, Katie, and thank you all for joining us. I'm happy to have you here. So we originally scheduled this webinar to talk about the June 22nd White House proclamation regarding the suspension of some of our work visas, and we will talk about that today for sure. As I'm sure you've heard by now this week, we've also been reeling from the news that there's new guidance from the U.S. government regarding international students here in the States and abroad. So if you have questions about that, we'd be happy to address those questions as well. Just write them in the chat. They don't tend to be in our pre-configured questions because we hadn't had them earlier. So back to the June 22nd order, that order, as you probably know, temporarily suspends the issuance of new H-1Bs for skilled workers. It suspends also H-2B visas for temporary or seasonal unskilled workers, which would not apply to PIT, and also for L-1 visas, which allow intercompany transfers or managed. None of those would apply to PIT. The one that really applies to PIT is the H-1B. The order also suspends the issuance of J visas in the categories of interns, trainees, teachers, camp counselors, or workers in summer work travel programs. Again, most of those categories are not ones that PIT uses regularly, so they don't affect us as much. The order also does not apply to lawful permanent residents. It doesn't apply to spouses or children of U.S. citizens. It doesn't apply to any person whose entry would be in the, quote, national interest of the U.S. as determined by the Secretary of State or the Secretary of Homeland Security. At the same time that this is happening, I'm sure you also know, that U.S. consulates abroad have been closed for visa stamping appointments. In some places and in certain circumstances, emergency appointments seem to be available. However, we've mostly heard about consulates which allow for the scheduling of appointments only to cancel or postpone them shortly before the scheduled date. In addition to that, travel bans have been issued which exclude visitors from entering the U.S. if they've been in one of approximately 30 banned named countries within the last 14 days. As if that situation wasn't dire enough, USCIS recently announced that it would be forced to undergo a mass layoff of 70% of its workforce beginning on August 3rd, unless they receive a loan from Congress prior to that time. If that loan is not approved, we anticipate that those layoffs would begin on August 3rd and that they would continue until at least October 1st, which is the start of their new fiscal year. And we don't know how long that would last, if it would go beyond October 1st or not. As you might imagine, the layoff of 70% of your workforce would certainly cause significant delays in USCIS application processing. We would anticipate that premium processing would almost certainly be suspended again for that time. All of this put together have deeply curtailed travel and immigration around the world. I know that all of you are wondering what effects the recent events have on our employees and students and the department's ability to hire foreign nationals. Please do keep in mind that all of this is very new. It's unclear. Circumstances are rapidly evolving. OIS is scrambling to keep up with the latest guidance that comes out and what it means for us, and we will continue to do that. Today, we can only speak to what we know is true and what is happening currently. It may change tomorrow. We understand that the need to hire qualified candidates from around the world is great, and we are working to mitigate the effects of the proclamation and guidance and visa closures and all of that as best we can. And I hope that you will understand that we simply don't have all of the answers yet. And we're working as hard as we can and as best we can with you all. And I know that you are doing the same. We do hope that this webinar will provide answers to some of your questions. Feel free to write additional questions, as Katie said, in the chat box. What we won't get today, we will attempt to answer and put on that website that Katie alluded to earlier today. So, Katie, let's go ahead and get into questions.
All right, Dilo, the first question is, how does the June White House proclamation affect Pitt, and for what amount of time is it in place?
Okay, so as I said, the employees most affected by this proclamation are current and potential H-1B visa holders who are outside the U.S. without a visa stamp. And then the proclamation also affects the J-1 interns, which we typically have a handful of on campus. It does not affect, as we said, J-1 research scholars, short-term scholars, or professors, which are the majority of the J-1 cases we handle. At this time, the proclamation is slated to expire on January the 1st, but it states in it that the possibility of an extension beyond that time exists.
Okay. So who can departments still hire, Dilo?
As always, we can always hire as many U.S. citizens and permanent residents. Anyone who is within the United States who's eligible to continue working on their current visas or who would be eligible to change to a visa status. That would include J-1s, that would include OPT and STEM OPT, it would include H-1Bs, it would include Os, it would include basically anything you've ever done if those people are currently in the United States and we can either do extensions or changes of status, we will have no problem doing that. TNs for Canadian visas are also valid, and remember that TNs have to be done for Canadian citizens. It does not include permanent residents of Canada. So I think we'll be talking a little bit later about what your options are to replace the H-1B. TNs for Canadian citizens and Mexican citizens are both good possibilities if you happen to have people from those countries. In addition, E3 are good options for Australian citizens if we have any of those. We have to remember once again that for anyone coming from outside the US, with the exception of Canadian citizens, they are still going to be limited by the visa appointment unavailability right now. And then finally, we can continue offering and hiring O-1 visa holders, whether they're in the U.S. or abroad, once the consulate's open for stamping.
So, Dilo, who is the most challenging to hire?
Well, again, it would be the H-1B visa holder who is outside the U.S. without a valid visa stamp in their passport. Unless their work is related to the quote national interest, and or COVID-19 related research, they would not be able to receive their visa stamp until at least January 2020 and possibly beyond that.
2021.
I'm sorry, 2021. My bad. OIS does have a document, and Brianna can walk those of you who have cases that are currently pending or that will be coming up. Brianna can walk you through a document that we've put together which talks about the options that might be available as alternatives to the H-1B.
I'm going to pause just for a second before I ask the next question, because a lot of people are putting in questions about students in the chat room. And okay. I just wanted to let you know, if you have questions from international students, please email them to OIS. We actually already have frequently asked questions up on our website for graduate and undergraduate students. And so we would be able to add those if they're not there already. But I will give all of you the website to direct students to in the chat room so that they can find the answers to those questions. And those questions are both for incoming and continuing students. Okay. So the as I write that website for everyone, Brianna, can you talk about whether people can still request J-1s?
Yes, yes they can. You would request it just like you normally would through our system, provide the same documents and information. We're kind of fortunate in that the presidential proclamation wouldn't apply to most of the categories we typically use. That being said, there's still some other complications that we have to consider. Like for instance, Pitt has suspended its J-1 program indefinitely. We're accepting requests starting August 1st and on. If you wanted to put a later start date, if you wanted to play it really safe and put January, that's fine. We can accept that too. But you know, that's the first complication. We do hear that Pitt is going to issue a new travel policy soon. So we're kind of waiting on that before we can do anything, because it'll definitely affect our J-1 scholars entering the U.S. and, you know, being on campus. So we're waiting on that. Once we get word on that, hopefully we can start processing paperwork and sending that out and getting the ball rolling. But no matter what the new travel guidance might say, August 1st might still not be a feasible start date, even if our people are exempt from that travel ban, simply because, you know, the consulates are closed, so they can't get visa stamps. There's travel bans for countries, flight scarcities. You know, there's a lot of complications just to entering the U.S. So August 1st at this point being, you know, July 10th may or may not happen. So you might want to, you know, talk to your department, talk to your scholar and see if there's maybe a later date that would work better. You know, but that's completely up to you guys. We're willing to accept start dates August 1st and on.
Okay. So Brianna, when would it be reasonable to say that they could start working at Pitt?
And that is a difficult question. Yeah, it's a difficult question. You know, like I was saying, there's on top of just having J-1 program suspensions, there's so much that goes into traveling internationally at this time. The one thing I didn't really go into was the travel bans from these countries. I mean, there are ways to request emergency appointments. So let's say you get an emergency appointment and you can actually get a stamp to come in. Okay, great. But you're from somewhere in Europe or you're from China and you have a travel ban. Okay, so the only way to get around that is to go to a third country, stay there for 14 days, and then you can enter the U.S. But once you enter the U.S., then you also have to do another 14 days of self-isolation. So, but let's say someone is actually willing and able to do all of that and they arrive in the U.S., right? At that point, pending any HR or onboarding requirements, they can start working. So it's complicated, it's difficult, it's not impossible. I can't tell you exactly when somebody will be able to start working for Pitt. It really just depends on, you know, whether they're able to overcome all these obstacles.
Mm-hmm. So, Brianna, can departments still file H-1B petitions for new employees who are outside the U.S.?
We can still file H-1B petitions like normal for people if they're outside. We hear that USCIS will continue to adjudicate these petitions like usual. However, we don't suggest requesting a start date before January 1st, 2021, unless we have reasonable assurance that your candidate might be doing COVID-19 related research, or that they might qualify for a national interest exemption, which is something that, you know, please talk to me or someone in our department about, so we can sort of vet that and see if, you know, we have a decent case to, you know, plea on that. But please be aware that starting dates may have to be postponed even past January 1st, you know, for travel related reasons, if the person can't get a stamp. Also, if the proclamation will be extended, that will affect the start date. Should any of those things happen, we can keep that approved H-1B alive until your employee can enter the U.S. Because they're not in the U.S. and they're not trying to maintain status, we are not required to pay the employee if they're outside of the U.S. and not yet working with Pitt. So, and if at any time in that process the candidate backs out of the process, we can withdraw the petition at that time. So we have some options.
So can people who are currently in the United States still transfer, extend, or amend their current visas?
As long as they're within the permitted maximum time frame, yes. Employees currently in the U.S. who need to extend their current unexpired H-1B or J-1 visas can still do so. And we can also do changes of status for people on valid current visas. Like for instance, we do a lot of OPT to H-1B, or a lot of J-1 to H-1B. So we can do all of those as long as they're here in the U.S.
What if they travel? So if current H-1Bs or J-1s want to travel and they have a valid visa stamp, is that acceptable?
Theoretically, yes. If you have a current visa in your passport and it will be unexpired by the time you re-enter the U.S., in theory, you can travel using that even if you're an H-1B holder. However, if your visa is currently expired or will expire before you plan to return, you'll need a new visa stamp to get in, you'll need to get an appointment, then you get caught in that complicated process. And for those who have H-1Bs, they may or may not be able to get another stamp to re-enter. So, you know, at this time, Pitt is strongly discouraging international travel to begin with, just because there's so many complications and risks involved. So, you know, even though you can, doesn't mean you should.
What advice do you have about families?
And you know, this is a kind of upsetting one, because unfortunately that the presidential proclamation bans, it specifically mentions the dependents of J-1 and H-4 visa, J-1 and H-1 visa holders. So anyone who's outside of the U.S., even if their spouse or their parent is in the U.S. currently with a valid visa, if they're outside and they don't have a valid visa stamp as of June 22nd, they're not able to enter the U.S. until at least next year.
D'Lo, can you answer this question? Can employees work remotely?
Yeah, so if we're talking about can they work in other countries, that's an issue that is currently being discussed by a number of people at Pitt. And I know, for instance, that they've hired a firm to conduct some risk assessments on people in various countries. The issue is there are tax implications, and there are also in some countries legalities that make it difficult for a person from Pitt to be working in that country. And the question is whether or not we then have a permanent presence in that country, which triggers some other things. So there are definitely a group at Pitt working on those issues. And I would suggest if your department has someone who is, let's say, stuck out of the U.S. right now, but you would like to keep them on as an employee in the fall, contact us and we can put you in touch with the group that's looking at that for some clearer answers.
Okay. When departments are submitting their paperwork for these requests, Brianna, should they do premium processing for their cases?
I strongly recommend that. I actually checked the USCIS website and their processing timelines just a day or two ago. And I mean, as you might know, over the summer, the processing timelines were 2.5 to 4.5 months, but it recently jumped up to like 14.5 months to 16.5 months. And it's not August yet. No layoffs have occurred. I don't know how realistic these timelines are or if they're just anticipating. But that being said, it could get worse even. We just don't know. So I'm saying if premium processing is available, I would suggest from the very beginning, just go ahead and plan to do everything in premium processing. That way we can mitigate, you know, any delays that we might have. You know, I just want to avoid any delays if I can. And then also, that being said, cases who are, or people who are on H-1B currently, who are just trying to extend or transfer their H-1B from a different institution to our institution, they're a little less affected by this. As long as we file their extension or their transfer before their current H-1B expires, we don't necessarily need premium processing. Because they can work for up to 240 days after the expiration of their current H-1B. The problem will be if we get to the point where it's been 240 days and things are still backed up, then we might have to reach out to them and say, you know, we have to put you on a leave or something at that point. But just trying to avoid that, I would say if you are able and willing to do so, premium would be suggested.
Okay. So, Dilo, what about a national interest exemption? What's the process for that?
So the proclamation gave us very little information about it. Basically, it said there would be this national interest exemption and spelled out some rationale for what it might include, but it did not give any kind of guidance on how to make that request or what you should do. We do know that if your employee is going to be working on COVID-related research, those are the people that probably have the best chance of getting some sort of an exemption. Even then, though, we don't really know how to ask for that exemption. I would say if you have a scholar that you think might fall under this category, talk with Brianna. It is very likely that we would then refer you to an outside counsel to handle that just because the unknowns are so great and we would want the best chance of success if we go that route.
Great. Brianna, what other options are there other than H-1B and J-1?
There's a handful of other options. It really depends on the employee's circumstances and the job description. So I need to actually vet through all of that on a case-by-case basis. I'm more than happy to help you with any of that, see if anything else is an option. Like we said, proclamation does not include J-1 research scholars, short-term scholars, or professors. So that's a large group of people there that would be exempt. So likewise, we can do O-1 visas for aliens of extraordinary ability. We can do TNs for Canadians rather easily, potentially Mexicans once consulates reopen. And then E3s for Australians. So those are the easiest ones, but we're more than happy to look at your case and determine if they're eligible for anything else. You know, we've been actively trying to do that in cases where that have come up where, you know, people might not be able to enter the US. So we're happy to continue doing that.
Okay. And then Dilo, can you talk about OPT for F1 students? People heard that that might be going away.
Yeah, sure. So there are currently a couple of challenges to OPT. The first is a lawsuit that's been pending for a while now. It is currently pending in a federal district court in Washington, D.C. I understand that there's a status hearing on that in September. And so I don't know how long we have to wait to see what's happening with that. But in addition to that, Stephen Miller, who is President Trump's senior advisor for policy, has made no secret of his desire to see more permanent restrictions on immigration, including an elimination of OPT. And we've also heard quite a bit of kind of rumors that things may be happening in this regard. In fact, the regulatory process has had on its agenda for quite a while now, some changes to OPT, and it never quite comes up, but we know that it's sitting there, and we know that, that they may be doing it. We have been hearing rumors about OPT being suspended immediately, like through a presidential proclamation or an order, an executive order. But most of the experts seem to think that that's pretty unlikely. And we suspect that there may be changes to OPT, but that whatever changes may happen will take a longer period of time, that they'll go through the regulatory process or this court case, and that would take a longer period of time. So that's kind of what we're looking at. No guarantees on any of it.
Okay.
I think we're ready to.
So I'm going to start asking the questions from the chat now, because we've gotten through the questions that had been emailed to us ahead of time. So can you, one of you, answer how, if at all, the J-1 limitations would affect J-1 students coming in?
So J-1 students are exchange students, and the exchange programs, both incoming and outgoing, have been canceled by Pitt for the fall 2020 semester. So even though the proclamation doesn't limit J-1 students, so under the proclamation we would be able to bring in J-1 students, under Pitt's policy there are not going to be any exchange programs for the fall semester.
Okay, can you talk a little bit, D'Lo, just generally about what happened this week in regard to SEVP guidance on students for the fall? Or, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. So everyone has heard this guidance has come out, and I need to back up a little bit to explain it. Under normal circumstances, international student is required to be a full-time student, and only one course per semester can be online and still count towards that full-time student status. So that's the typical rule. Back in March, when universities were switching to remote, SEVP came out very early on. It was quite surprising and welcomed. They came out very early on to say the normal rules are being suspended, and international students will be able to be remote just like any other student for the time being. They then extended that guidance through summer classes. So for the past several months, we in the field have been asking for further guidance about fall, and they've been promising that it would come. And the organizations were encouraging them to simply continue with the relaxed spring stance. And this week, as you know, they came out with the guidance that drastically backed that up. It is still not going back to the original and saying that students can only have one online class per semester. So in their view, they're saying we are way more relaxed than we normally are, because what they're saying is that students may not be in the U.S. and be completely online. As long as the students are in the country in a university that is offering in-person or hybrid courses, then the student will remain in status as long as they are enrolled in not only online classes. So Pitt will be able to certify, we have to do this on every international student's I-20, we must certify that Pitt is not in an online-only mode, and that each student is not taking only online classes. That's where it becomes tricky, because we know that some programs and some professors would like all of their classes to be online, and we are going to have to ensure that for an international student, they are not only taking online classes. On the other hand, and then we also have to certify that they're taking the minimal number of online classes they need in order to continue making normal progress toward their degree. So the difficulty is going to be to determine whether every student is taking a mix of in-person and online classes. That's the general rule, and that's talking about students who remain in the U.S. I know there were some questions about others, but I'm going to let those come up.
Okay. So a lot of the questions that we've been getting are things about registering for classes, what counts as an online class, how is that going to impact their status, things like that. Can you answer those questions?
I can try. We are working on a definition of flex at Pitt that we will be sending to SEVP and we'll have on our website that we believe will satisfy this hybrid requirement for courses. Again, having said that, it is important for programs and professors to understand that international students cannot be in solely on online classes, so that if the way you have interpreted hybrid means, well, I can choose to either be in person or online and I choose to be online, that's not going to work. And I know that there's a lot of talk at the dean level and otherwise all the way through campus about how to avoid that and what practices Pitt can put into place to make sure that all international students are taking at least some in-person classes or hybrid classes. The one thing I will say is that we are in the process of identifying also what hybrid means, and we're going to continue to work on guidance about that and roll it out as soon as we can. Basically, we are attempting to be as flexible as we can be under the guidelines. The real difficulty is that we don't know how stringent the government is going to be when they're reviewing these options, and we don't want to do anything that's going to cause potential damage to the student down the road. So we're weighing all of those things. We're coming out with our definitions. I really believe that Pitt is in a fairly good place compared to a lot of other universities, because we had already set up this Flex at Pitt plan. So I think we're in a good space, and I think we will be able to work it out with virtually all international students, that they will be able to remain here in hybrid classes and be okay for the semester. That's my hope.
But what I'm hearing you say is that the deans are a large part of this conversation. And so as far as the logistics go about how these courses would work, there was a question about whether the web attribute in PeopleSoft is going to be tagged on there. All of those decisions are being made at the dean level.
Yeah, yes. All of the decisions are being made at levels other than OIS for sure. What we are asking for, along with the rest of you, is some designation in PeopleSoft for how we will know when we look at a course, whether or not it is online or hybrid or in person. So one of the ideas that's being thrown around is whether or not the course has an actual classroom associated with it. That gives us some idea that part of that intends to be in person, and that's great if we can rely on that. But yeah, these are questions that are being asked at the at all levels, and folks other than OIS are working on the answers.
So, and I know that there are a lot of student questions in the chat right now. I did just want to tell you guys one thing about the website that I put on there in the chat room about fall 2020. If you go there, and that is actually where we're going to have a third page. Right now, there's a page for graduate students and a page for undergraduate students. That is where we're going to add the admin questions about fall as well. But if you go to the graduate website, you will see that we are having a webinar for graduate students to answer their immigration questions on July 17th. And if you are interested, you are more than welcome to register to attend that as well. We will also be recording that. And then if you go to the undergraduate page, you will see that we hosted a webinar earlier this week, and that video is already posted on that website as well. So again, please feel free to continue adding questions that you are receiving. We are always accepting questions on OIS@pitt.edu for students as well to add to those websites. So just to let you know, we do have plans for more information to go out to students, and you are more than welcome to attend any of those sessions as well. Brianna, I do have one question for you. Someone asked, they said that they have a postdoc in the J1 waiver process, and they have filed the paperwork, but it hasn't been approved yet, so that they could submit an H-1B, but the J-1 expires in November. So what suggestions do you have? Or is that a email me later situation?
Well, definitely email me later anyway, just so we can discuss it. But in general, if we're in the waiver process, it usually takes about 90 days. So it sounds like it might be close, but hopefully we can get the H-1 stuff filed before, you know, their J-1 expires and all that. Just talk to me, because it depends on the situation. We might be able to do something to help you out. It just depends on where he is in the process. So.
Great. We received another question, and Dilo, I feel like this one is more for you. Why hasn't Pitt challenged these visa bans and proclamations in court the way that some other institutions have?
You're asking the wrong person.
Dilo, we know you make the decisions for the university.
Yeah. The reality is that I know that Pitt has looked at a number of things and is currently looking at amicus briefs to sign on to, have requested information about some amicus briefs that are being added to the lawsuit about this most recent issue. Beyond that, the questions need to go higher up.
So another question that we got, and this kind of goes across all of the different visa types. What if the COVID situation in our area gets worse, and so we have to go back to completely remote?
So this is also something that we're working on and framing. What the new regulations say is that if the school, so we have to declare how the school is going to be operating by August. And we declare that to SEVD. So what we will be saying is that we are in a flexit pit mode, and that this is what it means, that we will be in person to the extent we can be while it's safe, and that sometimes we will transfer to online when it's not safe to be in person, and then we might transfer back depending on what the levels are at any given time. So we are making that statement from the beginning. The guidance then says if a school changes its mode of operation mid-semester then and goes completely online, students have to return home or transfer out. And that's the language that scares all of us. However, what we are arguing and what we believe is true is that Pitt will not be changing its mode of operation. The whole semester we are going to be flexit Pitt, and that allows for a fluid situation And so I'm continuing to work with legal counsel on this and with others, again, to try and define that in the best way we can. And we are hoping to, at all costs, avoid students having to leave mid-semester. I cannot give any guarantees because, again, I don't know how this is all going to be interpreted higher up or whether or not we're going to receive additional guidance. But we are working on language that we are hoping will protect our students.
So with all of the travel bans and the quarantines and everything else, is there a deadline for students to arrive on campus in order to be in status for the fall for in-person classes?
Right. So yes, and this was made in conjunction with conversations with provost's office and deans, and departments felt like ad drop deadline was the most reasonable date by which to say if a student is going to be in person, that's the date they should arrive. And so September 4th is that date. So that is the date that is the kind of deadline for new students to arrive on campus. Now your continuing students can come in and out much more freely visa-wise. So once they get their visas, they can come in, and it'll be up to departments to determine how fluid they can be with your coursework. But for new students, September 4th is that date.
Okay. We had another question about if a student has health concerns about coming back in person because of COVID, then what are their options, essentially?
Right. So one of the most confusing pieces of this new guidance is the part that talks about students remaining at home. And what the guidance currently says is that, and this gets complicated, so bear with me. If a student is attending a school that is completely online, that student is permitted to be in their home country and take a fully online course, and their CVIS record will remain active if they are a continuing student. And they can come into the country when they are able, after that semester, after they're no longer completely online. However, the guidelines also state that if a student is attending a school like Pitt that has hybrid classes or in-person classes, but they choose to or are forced to remain at home because they can't get visas or because they don't want to come back, those students are not permitted. They're permitted to take online courses. The government can't stop them from doing that. So they can take a full load of courses. They can keep up with their education, no problem. What we cannot do at this time is keep their CVIS record active. And so that means that most likely when they're ready to come in, we would have to issue them a new I-20 document. And that, the problem with that is that it restarts the clock for OPT and CPT. SEVP, a day after they put out the regulations saying what I just said, they put out FAQs that are directly contradictory to that statement. And those FAQs clearly say, if a student is taking a full load of online classes, they can continue to have their CVIS record active. And that's actually the guidance that we sent out with the student emails. However, this continues to be very, very conflicting and uncertain, and so we're sort of waiting for additional guidance. Right now, if I'm advising a student, I have to say I cannot be positive that your I-20 will be able to be kept active if you remain outside taking a full load of classes.
So we had a question about how Canvas works in China and how there have been reported issues. I'm actually going to answer that one. Nobody minds. So We have heard that as well. And so the university is actually requesting volunteers of students who are currently in China to test the Canvas system to see whether they can use that reliably in China or whether it would be easier for them to install a VPN and try to use that access to get everything that they need through our system. Our office has actually been requesting volunteers and then sending them to this testing group. So that is something that we are working on in order to let students know more fully what their options are, but we just don't have answers quite yet because we're still working on that. So the next question is about students who are graduating. If they are supposed to graduate in the fall term, then do they need to come back into the United States?
No, I mean, typically if a student is graduating, the biggest concern immigration-wise is whether or not they can get OPT after they graduate. And for those students who aren't interested in that and want to remain at home, there's absolutely no problem. We don't have to do anything with them. They are actually in very good shape. If they can finish their coursework from home, they're great.
And D'Lo, how is that, how is it different, or what would be the answer for a PhD student who is now done with their coursework and just working on their dissertation?
So PhD students working on their dissertation, typically speaking, are kept in SIVA status even during normal times. And we are not intending to do anything differently with them because we don't see it as any different than normally. And nobody has told us we need to do anything differently. So for your PhD or graduate students who have that notation in their transcript, in their academic record, that they are working on their PhD dissertation, we'll treat them like we always would. And if we would have kept them in active SIVA status, we'll continue to do that. They should be in touch with their OIS specialist, their immigration specialist, just so that we know where they are and what they're doing, but it should not be a problem to keep them in active status.
And what about graduate students who are in graduate student researcher positions, doing TA, all of those different things?
You know, again, I'm going to say if that is normally what you would do, and you would normally register them for the 9 credits, then yes, continue doing that. We don't want to do anything different with those PhD and MFA students this semester than any other time. I don't see it as any different.
Okay. Brianna, there was a question for you about if someone was thinking about bringing a person in on H-1B, but is now considering a J-1, is bringing someone in on a J-1 and then doing a change of status to H-1B a feasible option, or are there concerns with doing it that way?
In general, it just depends on the person, their immigration history, what they're eligible for. And then also the job position. If the job position is eligible for a J-1, like for instance, a postdoc can be brought in on an H-1B or a J-1. So let's say we bring in a postdoc, they're otherwise eligible, they come to the US in J-1 status, you know, work for a year, and then you wanna do an H-1B. That's fine, that's perfectly acceptable. Some concerns we might have with the process, sometimes J-1s are subject to a 2-year home residency requirement, which might require a J-1 waiver. You know, we had a recent question about that as well, but that might be a concern. But as long as the person is eligible for the H-1B and the position is eligible for an H-1B, which is of course something I'm more than happy to confirm, then there shouldn't be too many concerns with that. We actually have J-1 to H-1B changes often.
Thank you. Another question for D'Lo about the flex at Pitt. Is there a particular number of credits, you know, like normally there's the one class that can be online. Is there a particular percentage or balance for flex at Pitt of what's in person versus online instruction?
I can't answer for flex at Pitt. For immigration purposes, the guidelines are really, really, really vague. And so we will interpret them as broadly as we can and say that if there is a requirement for in-person coursework exams, if there is some requirement for them to be in person for some part of the semester, then according to the way I'm reading the regulations, that qualifies as a hybrid class.
So you had mentioned earlier when we were talking about employees being able to work remotely from other countries, that a lot of people at the university are looking into that for tax reasons. Does that answer also apply to TAs who are in their home countries teaching online?
Yes, absolutely. If you've got a TA that you want to have to begin work, you've got to go through the process of letting this group know, and you can email us and we can put you in touch with Ian McLaughlin is the person that you'll be in touch with at first because he's sort of organizing this group, but there are a lot of other people involved as well, and they will all look at it and again may have to have this feasibility study done on whatever country your TA is currently in. But they are really attempting to gather data about how many people we're talking about that might be overseas in any given country. So it's important that you let us know.
And I think one of the things to remember about all of these different options is that, you know, we want everyone to feel and be as safe as they can be. And so what we are trying to do is let people know what their immigration options are and their academic options are and their employment options are so that they can make the best decisions with you for how to move forward. And so, again, that's why we are continuing to have these meetings with you and the students and having these websites with all these different options available. But this, as far as the academic decisions go and some of the employment decisions go, those are things that have to be made at a senior level in order to figure out what we're going to do as an institution moving forward. So one question that we just got, are export controls and issues for individuals working abroad, especially when doing research?
Yeah, they're definitely an issue. And they are part of this committee that is looking at people who are needing to or wanting to be working from overseas. So they're all part of the same group that I talked about that will be looked at. Okay.
And then if someone is working for the university in OPT status, if we go fully online, how are they affected?
If they're working, not. Yeah.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
So we have another question about, I'm just going to read this one verbatim because I don't really understand what it's saying, and maybe if I read it out loud, I will. Since students cannot register for FTDS until having 72 credits completed, is PhD 3000 research recognized and treated like FTDS by your office and for SEVIS purposes?
I believe so, and I have to qualify that because I am so unfamiliar with Pitt's research courses, and I have not worked with students directly at Pitt, so I will have to defer that to our student team, and none of them are with us today. So I believe that it is the case that any of those research classes will be considered in person. And again, we'll treat it just like we would normally treat it. And remember that always we're looking at this in any semester, we have to look at whether or not a student is online for more than one semester. So if those courses have worked in the past for CS and, you know, OIS hasn't had a problem with it, I'm going to guess they're going to work again. It shouldn't be treated any differently.
So there was another question about how courses are going to be designated in person versus online only. And D'Lo, you mentioned the possibility that the classroom listed in PeopleSoft is one of the options. Right. Okay. So you don't know that that's what people are going to end up doing. So if no, one dean says,
I know that there is an issue with that. I know that there were problems with that, that being the only option. So that was one thing that was thrown around. I don't know what else is being thrown around. I know that people are talking about how to do this. And I don't know what the answer is going to be.
Okay. And just to let you guys know, in historically, when we talk about online classes, there is that web attribute that you can say on a class that this is an online course. That's what we've used historically. Whether or not we continue to use that or there's going to be a new way to designate classes, whatever the university and the deans decide, we will adapt because that's going to be not just for international students, but that's how the courses are going to be designated for everyone. So we will figure it out from there. Is that accurate, D'Lo, in your opinion as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so students, here's a question about students in China who cannot get visa appointments and therefore don't have the option to come into the United States. What will happen with their I-20s and will that affect their ability to take online classes?
It will absolutely not affect your ability to take online classes. That online classes can be taken outside the U.S. no matter what your immigration status is. It may affect your I-20 depending on what the guidance and FAQs end up saying. We have to get more guidance on that. So your I-20 might be terminated if you are outside the country and doing online work, but you may absolutely continue to do that online work. You will get your credits and do the online work.
Again, just to be clear, the F1 student status is saying that you are going to be physically studying in the United States. And so if Pitt had an online program, you wouldn't need F1 immigration status to do that from another country. You would
under normal circumstances.
Correct. You would normally just need to come in, need that status to come into the United States. So we have one more question and then we're going to wrap up because we're getting close to the end of the hour. So the question was, is there an online option for PhD students unable to get visas and who pays for their tuition?
Yeah, so that is a program by program decision. An online student has to talk with the program, and if you are the program, then you're going to have to make these decisions. The program will have to determine how and whether they are going to be able to offer their graduate students coursework and or if it will be necessary for that student to simply defer attendance or take a leave of absence if they're a continuing student. That's a programmatic decision.
Okay. So I am going to put the website again here in the chat room for everyone. We will send you an email when the new page is available for you as admins to get the answers to additional questions on there. Thank you all so much for your questions today and, you know, all the help that you do with our international community here at Pitt. We really appreciate it. If you get questions that you are unable to answer, please send them to ois@pitt.edu. And we will add them everywhere that we can in order to get the answers into the hands of the people who need them. And thank you very much. Is there anything else you guys wanted to say?
I was just going to answer the very last question very quickly and say we have no information about any embassies opening. They have not been forthcoming in Korea or anywhere else about when they might be opening. So no, I'm sorry. We have heard reports that students are beginning to get visa appointments, but then when those appointments come near, they just get rescheduled or canceled. So no, sorry, we don't have any more information. And as Katie said, thank you so much for joining us. I appreciate it. And please feel free to continue asking the questions and letting us know what the concerns are.
Thank you, everyone. I'm going to stop recording.
Yeah.